I'm going to ask you to join me in welcoming our first guest to the stage. Jonathan Mildenhall has spent 3 decades in marketing. He got his start in the agency world in England, where he's from. He spent 8 years at Coca-Cola, where he won the 2013 Creative Marketer of the Year Award at the Cannes Lion International Festival of Creativity. Then spent 4 years at Airbnb as CMO, and that was where I had the opportunity to work with him on some incredible campaigns. Last year, he founded a marketing consultancy called 21st Century Brand. He and his husband also just welcomed their first children, beautiful son Oliver and daughter Dominica, just a few weeks ago. So please join me in thanking Jonathan for emerging from paternity leave to be here with us today and chat with us further about just how good for the world we can be.
Yeah, I look slightly different, don't I? This is pre-kids and this is post-kids. Okay, over the next 45 minutes, I am going to share with you some thinking on what it takes to be a truly purposeful and impactful 21st century brand. And I'm going to share this, the deck, the full deck, which is available to anybody. You can just ask the conference organizers and they'll send you a link to the full deck. The full deck has got dozens and dozens of case stories in it. I'm only going to share with you some edited highlights, but I'm going to keep coming back to how Airbnb applied this new model for creating a 21st century brand, because I do think the Airbnb case story over the last few years, from a $1 billion valuation to a $35 billion valuation, being one of the few unicorns that is actually profitable pre-IPO, is something that is relevant to you all. So my company, 21st Century Brand, is a marketing consultancy. We work with founders and CEOs of disrupting companies to create some of the most influential brands of our time. There is this social media hashtag that we'd encourage you all today to follow along with. And if anybody wants to engage in the conversation with me outside of today, then you can always find me at Mildenhall on Twitter and Mildenhall on LinkedIn. So as I say, my company, set up 18 months ago, is really focused on our mission, which is building the most influential brands of our time. And in just 18 months, we've grown to 35 people. We've got 5 people in London, 30 people here in San Francisco. And we help Pinterest through their IPO. We work with GoDaddy. I'm in the middle of WeWork's IPO right now. And that's pretty dynamic, I have to say. Peloton, Uber Eats, Uber, Airtime, Sean Parker's social media platform, as well as just last week we picked up Nextdoor and N26, which is Europe's second most valuable unicorn. Now, one of the reasons why we're attracting this kind of business is because we've got this new model. And this is something that I would ask you all to be thinking about as you go through the day. Now, you'll find that there is a little scorecard under each of your chairs that you should use just to kind of plot where you feel you are as an organization in terms of your journey towards becoming an iconic 21st century brand of purpose and substance. So there are 4 pillars that I would encourage everybody to think about. First of all, purpose-led. Usually, disruptors are born out of purpose. Secondly, community-driven. Usually, disruptors have to find ways of engaging the community in terms of marketing development and product development. Thirdly, tech-enabled. Now, the business can be built on technology, but even if the business isn't built on technology, then using technology to effectively market to your community. And then finally, which you'd think is most obvious, but isn't often apparent, and that's narrative-based. Excellence in storytelling. Storytelling is the currency of humankind. It's not the dollar, it's not the pound, it's not the euro. Storytelling is the currency of humankind, and it's quite often startling quite how bad we are at telling stories to investors, to employees, and to the communities we serve. So let's just take a look at Airbnb in 2014. In 2014, Can you imagine? I was SVP of marketing for Coca-Cola North America. My budget was $1.2 billion. And I got a call from the founders of Airbnb, and they said, hey, could you come and help us build the next iconic brand? At the time, there were only 400,000 homes on the platform. A total of 36 million nights had been booked. There were 18 million unique guest check-ins. The valuation was less than my annual marketing budget, which is insane. And Airbnb's total integrated budget, which was performance marketing, brand marketing, PR, policy, on a global basis, was $25 million. My mom thought it was career suicide to leave Coca-Cola and join Airbnb. But it was through the application of those four pillars that I've just taken you through that Airbnb became the most influential travel brand of our time. So let's just take a deeper look into purpose. I'd encourage you all to just spend time, whenever the purpose of the organization is challenged, spend time online, because there are an increasing number of articles, academic think pieces, data-driven research studies that prove out that purpose-driven organizations are much, much more able to compete today than that of their non-purpose-driven competitors. And this headline really sums it up. Purpose-driven companies do better because they're more ambitious. They have a purpose that they believe in. Everybody in the organization gets behind it. They attract great talent. They inspire innovation. They make faster decisions because it's easier if the decision-making is around the purpose. They're more trusted. They get increased levels of loyalty, and they attract investment. Now, as Kate has already said, you know, there was a time that purpose-driven organizations were leading the march on purpose, but now the world's most influential corporates are also turning their attention to purpose. And so the Business Roundtable, and as Kate just pointed out, there are these four drivers now of profit. Delivering value to customers, number one. Investing in our employees, number two. That means, you know, training and development and salaries where people can actually afford to live. Dealing fairly and ethically with our suppliers and supporting the communities in which they work. If you as an organization are not taking those four mandates seriously, then chances are you're going to be left behind. And even the world's most powerful private equity investor, Larry Fink, has also been declarative in the fact that purpose is not the sole pursuit of profits, but it's the animating force behind them. And the reason he believes that is as divisions continue to deepen, companies must demonstrate their commitment to the countries, regions, and communities they operate, particularly on issues central to the world's prosperity. So when you start to see private equity leaders, the most influential private equity leader, saying that corporations need to now step up and, to be honest, fill some of the space that governments, local and national governments, are creating, then there has never been a better time to invest in a brand that matters. So why now? Well, first and foremost, you're not going to attract, and I see that this is a relatively young audience, but you're not going to attract a younger workforce unless there is a very, very clear stance for something that is bigger than just profit. It's getting harder to recruit and retain young talent, particularly tech talent, as tech workers want to be seen to be solving some of the world's biggest problems. A rising number of consumers are making purchases based on a company's social purpose. And the media is actually applying a lot more pressure on CEOs to take stances on political and social issues. And if a CEO and a company isn't clear of its purpose, then it can expose itself to significant vulnerabilities in a split second if they're undefined and there's a crisis that can confront a particular business. So who does purpose well? Well, I always like to start my presentations by going back to Coca-Cola. Coca-Cola is 150 years old, and it's always been a brand that has brought people together and a brand that has helped in very, very small ways divide significant cultural tensions. The reason why it's relevant to share with you this particular ad all over again is it was in 2013 that the Facebook team and I were figuring out how we might collaborate and do something really interesting at Super Bowl. And I had this beautiful anthemic spot, and Carolyn Eveson and Mark Darcy, the chief creative officer of Facebook, they flew to Atlanta, and we sat down and we basically brainstormed how we might be able to turn a 60-second ad into a massive conversation-driving experience during the Super Bowl. And they started to talk to me about micro-targeting. To be honest, I had no idea what they were talking about, but they were basically saying, yeah, it's a vignette ad, and now we've got such sophisticated technology on the Facebook platform that we'll just take the LGBT vignette and we'll push it out to the LGBT community. We'll take the Mexican vignette and we'll push it out to... I didn't realize that Facebook's technology was that sophisticated. I mean, now it makes complete sense. But at the time, 2013, Coca-Cola and Facebook were the first brand to actually genuinely do a universal conversation on the back of the Super Bowl down to tightly targeted work. And it created the biggest conversation in Coca-Cola's history. And it's just such a beautiful ad that depicts the ever-changing face of the American family.
Oh, beautiful for spacious skies.
Por tus olas de granos tambar.
Your peachy nuts
Soy baba ng mga brutas.
America, America, God shed his grace on.
So a beautiful ad that with Facebook technology we were able to micro-target. To this room, that ad is nothing provocative or contentious, I dare say. But that ad actually exposed a real deeply ugly underbelly of America when that ad was first run. And what was interesting is, you know, now leaders are all on social media, and so you feel very exposed when you do something as a leader that's quite kind of brave. And I got a lot of hate directed at me on Twitter after this ad ran. And there was this one tweet that said, "Hey, Mildenhall, you're black, you're gay, you're British. Why don't you F off back to the UK and stop messing around with the American national anthem?" Well, I was like, yes, I am black, I am gay, I am British, but that's not the American national anthem, so your intelligence isn't anything that I should worry about. But I'm still very, very proud, and what made me doubly proud is in 2015, Coca-Cola re-ran that spot after the presidential elections because the Coke, the leadership team, felt that that message was even more resonant. 2 years later, the only ad in Super Bowl history to run in two different years. Okay, so that's kind of purpose from an iconic brand, telling big stories on a big platform like the Super Bowl. But if you haven't got those kind of budgets, can you do actions that help put your purpose front and center? And as a result, generate huge conversation, and as a result of that conversation, create market leadership for you as a brand. And there is no better example of a brand acting out its purpose than REI. And it's worth just taking a look at this case story film, because it's brilliant when a brand acts and gets the world to listen. The marketing efficiencies of this campaign are really, truly incredible. So much more efficient than Coca-Cola's Super Bowl commercial.
In the news tonight, another Black Friday has arrived.
Retailers opening their doors earlier
chaos
this year.
Chaos erupting when someone tried to cut
the pushing line. It was a chaotic scene.
Taking a stand against the Black Friday frenzy, a major retailer is refusing to open on Black Friday this year.
REI.
The outdoor retailer REI.
All of its locations will be closed on Black Friday.
And it won't be processing any sales online.
It will pay employees to take Black Friday off.
To spend time outdoors.
This Black Friday, we're closing all 143 of our stores. We'd rather be in the mountains than in the aisles. Join us on November 27th at Opting Outside.
More retailers are joining REI, deciding to close their doors on Black Friday.
Purpose-driven marketers, and I would encourage you to think of actions rather than the stories that your company can take that will generate a whole number of stories to really differentiate your business. Now, you're all disruptors, 21st century companies born in the digital age, but it's important that we keep an eye on the big multinationals, because the big multinationals are also turning their attention to purpose, as this clip shows.
Yeah, bonjour, Caroline, from hot and sunny Cannes. Yeah, first time in this festival of creativity.
You're here on a mission. You want to fight against all these brands who make a fake advertising, fake purpose in advertising, basically making empty promises and then not taking any actions. This is something that you call woke washing. Why is it so bad for the industry?
Yeah, the real mission that we're here on is to land the point that business can be a force for good in the world. Business and our brands, we think, can take meaningful action to address some of the big issues that the world is facing. And at a time when trust is breaking down in society, it's very important that any promises that our brands or other brands make are backed up by real action that we're taking in the world and in the community.
So obviously this includes some brands also within the Unilever group. How much do you think of your portfolio of brands actually have a real purpose at the moment?
Yeah, at the moment we've called out 28 brands in our portfolio, which across multiple countries are taking action to address an issue in society or the environment, and then sharing that message with consumers. Those 28 brands are growing much faster than the rest of our portfolio. So although this is good for the world, it's also good for our business. And they're now driving about 75% of our total growth. So they're a very, very important part of Unilever and our portfolio.
So you were talking, for example, Ben & Jerry's is a brand that obviously you want to keep in your portfolio because you think it's like a model in terms of purpose.
Yeah, thanks, Caroline. Ben & Jerry's is just a fantastic business. It's a brand and a company that sits within Unilever. And for decades now, they've taken on and championed some of the biggest social issues in the world. At the moment, they've got a very interesting campaign running, which is around criminal justice and equality in the US criminal justice system. So at a time when many states in the United States are legalizing cannabis, what they're discovering is that it's the already rich people who are profiting from the legalization of cannabis while many in the minority communities remain locked up for trivial offences. So that's what they're campaigning for right now.
So
they're a great model for us within Unilever.
So which brands do you think you want to divest in that case? Would you divest, for example, skin whitening creams, Fair and Lovely in India? Is that something, for example, that does not have a purpose?
Yeah, so the brands that we are enjoying great growth on are brands like Dove and Lifebuoy and Domestos, which are taking action. And what we'll do is we will give all the brands in our portfolio a period of time to figure out how they can make a positive contribution to society, say a couple of years. And at the end of it, some may have discovered how they can contribute positively and some may not. And the ones that are not able to find a higher order role that they can play may well end up better owned by someone else.
So really important, when the multinationals start to talk about purpose-driven marketing and purpose-driven brand stewardship, it's only going to make consumer awareness for purpose-driven brands that much greater, which will make it more and more difficult for disrupting brands to cut through. So really important that we keep an eye on the big multinationals and monitor their actions as the world leads into purpose. And what about Airbnb? Well, Airbnb had this incredible purpose, which was to create a world where anyone can belong anywhere. Now, the LGBT community over-index on the Airbnb platform. Why? They have bigger homes with more space because they don't have kids, and they travel more because they don't have kids. And so when the transgender community was under siege a few years ago, Airbnb felt that it had to actually put out a message that talked about a world where the trans community should be recognized just as the male community and the female community. And it happened at that time that Caitlyn Jenner received the Arthur Ashe Award for bravery, and Coca-Cola actually pulled out of advertising during that particular show. And I got a call saying, hey, Coke's pulled its ad from the Caitlyn Jenner acceptance speech. Do you want to take it? Yes, I want to take it. I want to prove to the LGBT community that Airbnb recognizes them with the same creative elegance as it would recognize any other group. So I'm going to play 60 seconds of Caitlyn Jenner's speech, followed by the ad that we ran straight after it, which was just a way of saying to the trans community that they'd been recognized and they mattered.
All across this country right now, all across the world, at this very moment, there are young people coming to terms with being transgender. They're learning that they're different, and they're trying to figure out how to handle that on top of every other problem that a teenager has. They're getting bullied. They're getting beaten up. They're getting murdered. And they're committing suicide. The numbers that you just heard before are staggering, but they are the reality of what it's like to be trans today. Just last month, the body of 17-year-old Mercedes Williamson, a transgender young woman of color, was found in a field in Mississippi, stabbed to death. I also want to tell you about Sam Taub, a 15-year-old transgendered young man from Bloomfield, Michigan. In early April, Sam took his own life. Now, Sam's story haunts me in particular because his death came just a few days before ABC aired my interview with Diane Sawyer. Every time something like this happens, people wonder, could it have been different if spotlighting this issue with more attention could have changed the way things happen? We'll never know.
That was the context, followed by this ad.
Is mankind? Are we good? Go see. Go look through their windows so you can understand their views. Sit at their table so you can share their tastes. Sleep in their beds so you may know their dreams. Go see and find out just how kind the he's and she's of this mankind are.
Huge storytelling moment for Airbnb, but also a huge action moment as we lent in and placed media dollars behind that entire cultural narrative. So who gets it wrong? Well, a lot of brands are getting it wrong, and some great brands kind of fall asleep at the wheel and get it wrong in very surprising ways. From VW fighting the diesel scandal, Nike that has been a fantastic champion of female athletes, unless they were pregnant female athletes, Weight Watchers, which has been a great brand and helping adults lose weight, launch an app for 8-year-olds. Juul, one of the darling startups of the last few years, has really been embattled over the course of the last 18 months as its technology starts to get challenged from the health industry. And Victoria's Secrets, the CMO, ended up having to resign because he declared that transsexuals were not welcome in a Victoria's Secrets show. So brilliantly strong brands, really interesting technology, can often mess up. Community driven. And this is really where I think all of your investment should be in terms of really unlocking the innovation and the storytelling narrative for your brands. Community driven is one of the most efficient ways and one of the most authentic ways that you can build a brand narrative. And I'm just going to share with you two case stories, and they're both telecoms companies. If you haven't heard of this company, it's called Xiaomi, and it's the biggest smartphone producer in Asia. It's a huge, huge brand. And the reason why I wanted to share it with you is because I would like you all to just go to the Mi community, the website, because they've been incredibly generous in terms of creating a playbook for community-driven marketing, community-driven product innovation, and community-driven advocacy. And the website really does help people understand why in just 5 short years, this startup device manufacturer had been able to overtake Apple in China. And it talks about principles like creating a premise that resonates with your target audience, leverage that on social media with unique campaigns and unique promotions like flash sales. It also talks about the value of customizing your product and letting the company, the community, help you understand how to innovate with your product. And something that we're going to talk a little bit about later on, about fan festivals and meetups, the need, even if you're an online company, the need to create opportunities for your fans to actually meet offline. So Xiaomi is an incredible force of community-driven, and I urge all of you to check out its playbook online, because there are so many tips there that you will be able to take to really enhance your own approach to community-driven engagement. I also want to share with you the Shot on an iPhone campaign and that case story again, because you know Apple had built a reputation of being one of the most fiercely protecting brands on the planet. It didn't recognize its community. It didn't recognize its community's creativity. It was a brand that lived on a pedestal so far removed from the creativity of its own customers until they launched the iPhone 6. And as a result of that, Apple still to this day own an enviable place of being probably the most aspirational archive of community-driven content. And if Apple's community can create content that is as brilliant as this, imagine why can't your communities create brilliant content that you can take from your community and you can put paid media dollars behind it. It's a great case study, it's an inspiring case study, and I'd just like you to watch this film and just think about how you might be able to unlock the creativity of your own community and turn that into paid advertising.
These Apple billboards just changed. They're no longer ads. well, not traditional ads, they're photos all taken with the iPhone 6.
To world fame, all thanks to a cell phone picture.
How cool is it to see your photo on a billboard?
I have a big billboard, the largest billboard in Singapore.
One of my goals is to go to one of my billboards. I think there's one in New York.
Community-driven content can be iconic content. Community-driven content is more authentic than the content that you'd get from an advertising agency or from an internal marketing team. And I use Apple as a constant reminder to all of my clients just quite how powerful engaging your community's creativity can be. But for Airbnb, it was also really, really important that we invested. If we are a community-driven brand, then we have to invest in ways to bring our community together. And so experiential marketing is also a huge, huge driver of word of mouth and of loyalty and ultimately of advocacy. And so this is something that Airbnb does on an annual basis. It's incredibly powerful when it brings its community together. There are over 120 different nationalities represented when the Airbnb community get together at what we call Airbnb Open.
Airbnb has created a we company, not a me company.
We can get to know each other intimately and understand our collective narrative is a narrative for everyone, and that we all can belong in a world together without borders.
Unveil today a 32-page magazine exclusively from the world of Airbnb.
Thank you so very much.
I'm Jamie Foxx.
I'm Jeremy Piven.
We'll be right back.
Only 2 years ago that took place, and only 2 years ago Airbnb launched its first magazine. And now the Airbnb Travel Magazine is a business in its own right. It's the world's second largest travel magazine, and it is full of authentic content and authentic stories from the Airbnb community. So it would have been impossible to launch a magazine like this in 2014, but as a result of ongoing community engagement, Airbnb has now created the world's second biggest travel magazine. And who gets it wrong? Well, there are many examples of brands that get community wrong. Starbucks kicked off this entire race and racism debate, had to close down its stores because of the treatment of a couple of African-American men. You know, Spotify, its community is music artists, and it ran a campaign encouraging people to dance like nobody was paying. I mean, it's alienating the very community that built the platform. And Equinox and SoulCycle preach inclusivity, and then the chairman holds a fundraising event for Donald Trump. And nowadays, there is no opportunity to hide these things. Your brand is your chairman, is the board, is your employees. And if you're saying different things, then you risk alienating the community in very significant ways. So, but Airbnb also messed up its community. Messed up its community in a very, very serious way. In 2016, we were hyper-growing, we were preaching a world where you could belong anywhere, we were promoting the LGBT community in ways that hadn't been done before, and we ran into a glass wall because we realized that racism was rife on our own platform.
Accusations now surfacing about Airbnb, the popular home sharing site, where many hosts are being called out by users for rejecting them based on the color of their skin.
Martina Crittenden says she experienced racial bias on Airbnb. She started the hashtag Airbnb while black.
Being denied because of the way I look, I mean, it sucks.
New at 11, a controversy involving the popular travel site Airbnb is going viral.
So white guests 50% of the time got a yes, while African-American guests only got a yes 42% of the time. And you're
an Airbnb host in North Carolina is accused of sending vile messages to a business student.
Messages apparently from the Airbnb host that were so offensive, the company decided to ban him for life.
So you can't have a narrative where anybody can belong anywhere on Airbnb and then have a reality that is, except if you're African-American in the United States. And so the chief exec, Brian Chesky, brilliantly so, closed down 25% of the company's work streams, put on a cross-functional bunch of people. We introduced a new community compact, any guest, any host, zero tolerance for any form of bigotry on the platform. We introduced artificial intelligence that helped us listen to the conversations and monitor for a whole bunch of words and phrases that were not appropriate on the Airbnb platform. And we slowed down our growth as we got bad actors off the platform. As a result of all of that, in just 8 months, we were able to go from a crisis, a genuine crisis that was gonna compromise the very essence of Airbnb's purpose, to be able to run our first Super Bowl spot. So this goes down in history as Super Bowl's cheapest spot ever because it was shot by our in-house team. It only cost $65,000, but the year that we ran that, it was Super Bowl's most celebrated ad. So we were able to turn around our crisis because we held our purpose front and center, and then very publicly we went out and said, now Airbnb truly is a place that accepts everybody. So tech-enabled, really, really important that we put humanity into our technology. Who does tech-enabled well? Well, Starbucks has appealed to a whole younger section of the population as a result of its mobile app pre-ordering technology, changing the Starbucks experience, making it that much more efficient for many customers across the world. Sweet Green. Sweet Green is a great salad bar, to all intents and purposes. But they believe that they're going to use technology to completely reimagine the food chain, completely reimagine education in terms of customers' understanding of nutrition, and completely reimagine the overall customer service experience. Gucci, a fashion brand, a retailer, now boasts the world's most favorite fashion brand for Gen Z and the millennial population. Over 62% of its business comes from people under the age of 35, and it puts a lot of that down to using technology to enhance the retail experience online and offline for its target audience. And Airbnb is a tech platform, of course, but we use brilliant technology as a marketing initiative. So when we launched Airbnb Experiences, we asked Facebook to use their leading edge technology to help us create a marketing campaign that was truly differentiating as far as Airbnb's potential new customers who would be interested in the trips experience. So here's a great case story of where we just use cutting edge technology in a very human way as a marketing platform for Airbnb experiences.
We live in a connected world, but we are more divided than ever. Airbnb had a vision to bring us together.
You see, for many people, travel's easy, but it's not magical. Welcome to the world of trips.
On November 17th, Airbnb unveiled an app evolution, Trips on Airbnb, including hundreds of unique Airbnb experiences hosted by real people in local communities. But how do you launch a product centered around the power of human connection? By connecting people. We are here virtually transported people across oceans and borders to six unique Airbnb experiences around the world on Facebook over the course of 24 hours. We went live using first-person point of view so that you could participate real-time as if you were actually there.
Welcome to the Airbnb experience.
In each film, your comments were magically incorporated into the actual live Airbnb experience, a brand new way to engage with content. We went to Paris, where our host asked her guests to write down fears on paper butterflies as part of her performance art experience. As you joined in via comments, we wrote your fears down too. So when the butterflies were released in the Parisian sky, you got to experience your fears floating away. A few hours later, you made each other feel fabulous in Tokyo, literally surrounding the made-over guests with the world's words of encouragement. You went to an underground dance battle in Seoul and hyped each other up. You made arepas and shared stories of family and food in Miami. You pledged to protect the ocean in Cape Town. And you went outside your comfort zone and surfed in Los Angeles. You supported each other. More than 6 million people joined these Airbnb experiences in the first 24 hours. Those exposed to the campaign had a 7-point lift in favorability and a 22-point lift in ad recall. But this wasn't about a big stunt. It was about creating a meaningful shared experience. And on this day, we experienced the magic of human connection.
So I'm very, very proud of that partnership because it was the partnership directly with Airbnb and the creative shop here. We pushed the creative shop. They gave us their best creative people and pushed them to do something that they hadn't done before. That work still is recalled at Airbnb as being one of our great marketing moments. So if you're working with the creative shop, ask them to do work that is as brave and is as fresh and is as cutting edge as the stuff that they don't do with Airbnb, because it's pretty inspirational. And who gets it wrong? Well, really, most of the retail industry. It's such a crying shame that these big retailers cannot look at the ways that young customers today want to engage in terms of e-commerce. And there's just negative story after negative story of big retailers failing to embrace technology in a very relevant way. The final pillar is narrative-based. And this is something that I would, if I am critical of the disruptors, it's that the ability to tell compelling stories that incentivize and align the investors, the employees, and your community is there aren't a whole lot of brilliant examples, and there should be. And narrative-based is, as I said before, the currency of humankind. So really putting a premium on your internal and external storytelling expertise. Now, storytelling, quite often people go, oh, well, we haven't got the budgets to tell big stories. So I've deliberately pulled out the New York Times, because this ad that I'm going to share with you cost literally $5,000. But it is a brilliant story that creates a very, very unique positioning for the New York Times in today's marketplace.
The truth is, our nation is more divided than ever.
The truth is, alternative facts are just plain delusional.
The truth is, the media needs to be held accountable.
The truth is, locker room talk is harmless. The truth is, we need to put the safety of the American people
first. The truth is, we need a full investigation of any ties to
$5,000, how can you tell stories, tell narratives that are that impactful and that efficient to produce? With Airbnb, when I got there, the biggest narrative around Airbnb was, why on earth would you stay with strangers? Aren't you worried for your own safety? Aren't you worried for your own jewelry? Staying in somebody's house is weird. Stranger danger. And so we decided that we were going to just put the big tension of Airbnb's business model into the marketing. And the opening line of this commercial, it's still, I think, one of the bravest opening lines of any commercial, because the line goes, "Dear stranger, when I first booked this trip, my friends thought I was crazy. Why would you want to stay in somebody else's house?" We put that negative tension into our story so that we could basically slay that dragon. And as a result of this campaign, then Airbnb's valuation really skyrocketed. So if there's a tension around any of your business models, don't shy away from putting it front and center in your marketing communication.
Dear stranger, when I booked this trip, my friend said I was crazy. Why would I stay in someone else's house? But this morning, a city I've never been to felt like one I already knew. Everyone in your neighborhood was so warm and friendly. And your home was perfect and peaceful. Oh, and then I met your friends. They reminded me of my friends. It felt like I had known them for years. It was almost like family. I just wanted to thank you for sharing your world with me. It felt like home. Airbnb, belong anywhere.
Every single guest that you ever see in an Airbnb ad is authentic, recruited, cast from the community. Likewise, its hosts. Authenticity is something that is essential for storytelling today. And who gets it wrong? Well, I started this presentation celebrating Coca-Cola. I'm going to end this presentation having a close look at one of its competitors. Something that you all might be familiar with, but this film really kind of does break down quite how atrocious Pepsi's attempt at becoming culturally relevant really was. So it's worth the 90 seconds. Let's take a deeper look.
Took all my rights away. Telling me how to pray. Won't let us demonstrate.
huge attempt at being culturally relevant and a huge fail as it became culturally inappropriate. So these four pillars, the application of these four pillars has created a phenomenal success for Airbnb. In just 4 years, there are now 6 million homes on the Airbnb platform. In 2018, there were 200 million nights booked. 70 million unique guest check-ins for the year, a valuation at $35 billion, and Airbnb's global marketing budget has now increased to north of $500 million. And so, you know, spend time thinking about the application of these four pillars for your own business. I think every single organization should try and aspire to get 10 out of 10 on each one of these pillars. Because if you do get 10 out of 10 on each one of these pillars, then perhaps you can be the next $35 billion organization. Thank you very much.